Look out, Cairns, we're coming back. Saturday the 4th of October, 2025. It's on like Donkey Kong at the Cairns Performing Arts Centre. Get your early bird tickets for $45 going cheap, cheap. More info, rewind80sband.com. Cairns, we're coming back and we can't wait. See you soon.
Guys here, all dressed up. Did you go hunting for lollies?
We had a few kids come to our door.
Did you really? Did Maddie like go, fuck off?
No, no, no. We got the doorbell now so we can see them from miles away.
Oh, of course.
But then the second time I was walking around naked and they came to the door and they got a bit of a Halloween surprise, I'll tell you what.
And you went, whoa.
No, I did. I went, here, tits and ass. Here's your Halloween. You think you got the treat, not the trick.
Yeah, you got a You want to see a trick?
So you just don't think, because we don't have anyone come to our door and this is the only time the kids come around, you know, with their dogs and shit. But oh, it's cool with that. How's your week been?
Not too bad. We took Leo trick-or-treating tonight for the first time. He wasn't into it. He doesn't really like lollies, and he just sort of – he liked getting dressed – he liked me putting the makeup on his face because we did him up like a vampire. But he wasn't into the costume, which was strange. He kept taking it off and like running. Oh, no. I think he's a bit tired as well. But we – people would give you know, there'd be a basket there and some of it would be lollies, some of it would be fruit. He'd be picking the fruit out. He loves fruit.
Oh, yeah. Cute.
So he ate three mandarins on the way home, which was very
what
cute.
What a healthy kid.
Good on him. Bless him.
You can't teach that. Yeah. That's what his body wants, exactly you know?
Yeah. Other than that, I've had a bit of a shit of a week.
Oh, okay.
I've had a shit of a week.
What happened? You've had a shit of a week. I've had even more shit of a week.
I know. My mum's had COVID. Your dad's been in hospital. It's all happening.
It is. And the thing is, we had two corporates as well. So we had the Thursday night corporate for Finpro and the Saturday night for Marty's 50th birthday, which he was really 54, but they had a 50th because it was through COVID, which is exactly my scenario. And then from the gig, I had to go straight to my mum's and we've been in the hospital with my dad. He's going to be fine. He's just having this fluid in the lung thing and we can't get rid of it, but we're counting down what it could be and getting all the tests done. But, yeah, how was your week? Tell me what happened there.
Not too bad. My mum was sick. She finally came down with COVID. Half the guests at the wedding that we went to the other week got COVID. And she has never been sicker. I think this is the first time she's had it. She's had five shots. She's had five vaccinations. But she said it's the sickest she's ever been in her life. So we're really worried. She called the ambulance yesterday because sort of coughed so hard that she had hurt her back.
Yeah.
And she thought she might have been having a heart attack, but she's okay today.
They do cough so hard that you just don't know what they're going to do to their body, you know?
Yeah, exactly right.
And you can actually pull
your neck. Now.
Yeah, you can actually put your back out when you cough because 100%. It's just harder as you get older, but I hope my mum gets better very soon.
Yeah, that's right. She's a big listener to the show. So,
best wishes to your mum and my dad.
That's right. Big supporters of ours. As you mentioned, sorry to cut you off. We are the 80s montage. I'm Jay Jovi.
I'm Sammy Hardon. Welcome to the show tonight. And it's a ripper.
We're going to do one of our favourite topics, which is 3XY.
And it's hot albums. So we're doing the albums this 2nd of November 1984. If you're listening on YouTube, hey, you found us because we love as many people to write some comments and stuff on YouTube as well. Now, this is a really interesting time because we just did play a horror movie for Halloween by Skyhooks. I've got a bit of a Skyhooks fetish at the moment. Maddie and I are both into Shirley. Yeah, we're loving him.
Oh.
This was a 70s record but actually resurfaced in 1984 and charted again. So it was like a nostalgic thing. Yeah, amazing. And I think they were touring quite hard and stuff like that. But it's such a great album. Horror movie to go with Halloween as well. So the story is they think it resurfaced again because it was just nostalgic and everyone was listening to their stuff again and this album was number 30. So we're going from 30 to 1 and number 30 is Living in the 70s by Skyhooks. And Maddie and I were just talking before. He said you should play the sound check that Shirley Strawn does for this show at the Royal Showgrounds. Now, this guy, very underrated vocalist because he was quite high, fantastic placement. This is his sound check and I just want you all to have a listen to this. This is how all sound checks should fucking be, right? Here we go. February the 20th, Melbourne Music Show at the Showgrounds. How's his voice? The nick of it, like sitting right on top of the mix. Kudos to the sound guy. But just a beautiful placement.
Voice.
Exactly. And the thing is, he walks out with his hand in his pocket and he just goes to sound check this so easily. I mean, I've worked with some fucking name people and bands and, mate, they sound check for 3 hours and nothing gets done, you know. Not going to mention any names, but you would know.
Anything worse, to be honest.
It's you know what? Why sound check? Just fucking line check. But this Lisa Edwards was on BVs with this and Lindsay Fields and Vanetta Fields.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, so it was like a mixture of musos. And the voice is incredible. So I just wanted to play that because a lot of people love that video and stuff like that.
Very, very popular. I sort of have a fascination with Skyhooks as well. I don't know a lot about them. I love the music and I'd love to sort of look for the opportunity of looking at their 80s stuff. I mean, this is charting obviously in the 80s. It's released in the 70s originally. But I'd love to have a look at their activity in the 80s.
That's right. The only real one I remember in the 80s was Jukebox in Siberia, but that could have been 90s.
I think it's even 1990s.
I think it is. And but when it's amazing as you get older and you listen to these artists, you think to yourself, God, the musos are good in this, you know. And this was produced by Ross Wilson in the early days, and he sort of managed them before Gudinski took them over and made them who they were.
It sounds like Ross Wilson.
It does, doesn't it?
Explain that.
Exactly. Yeah. 100%. Rossi's in there for sure. So that was number 30, Living in the 70s, Skyhooks, Mushroom Records. Go Gudinski.
Now, do you mind if I cut in for 2 seconds? For anybody that might be joining us, 3XY, if you don't know, because we might have some new listeners on board and they may not know, 3XY was a radio station here in Melbourne that ran from 1935 right up to 1991. It was very big in the 80s, and they used to release these incredible chart lists that you could get, and you can actually sort of – that there's still sort of originals floating around. People sell them on eBay and stuff like that, and they're fascinating. Sammy and I love doing them because not all songs that charted at the time stand the test of time. You know what I mean? Like they sort of fall through the cracks of history. You know what I mean? Yet at the time, here they are. They're all sort of reflected within these charts. And it's we love looking at it just because it's actual factual chronicled history of the 80s. It's not the internet's version of the 80s.
Yeah.
So this is why we love it.
I cannot believe they started in 1935.
Yeah, 1935, and the original license was held by the Liberal Party. The rival station at the time was 3KZ, and that was owned by the Labor Party. The main programmer for 3XY was FT Studios, which was owned by Frank Thring Sr.
Oh,
I remember
hilarious.
Frank Thring's father owning a radio station.
Wow.
And Frank used to go on the radio stations with his mates, and they'd sing, just like they'd run competitions and stuff, and Frank would go on there and sing, and they'd sing like fucking, you know, "We're just a couple of swells, we stay in the cheap hotels," or whatever it fucking was.
Yeah.
And that Frank would win every week, and he was in there 1 week, and he said like, "Oh, we'll sing this song this week, and next week we'll sing this song." And one of the programmers said, "Oh, well, Frank, how do you know that you're going to get through to the next round? It's a competition." And he said, "'Cause Daddy owns the radio station."
That's awesome. And didn't Daddy take over the Regent Theatre at some stage as well and reopen that, or one of the theatres?
He did. They actually used to run 3XY out of the ballroom in the Princess Theatre
Okay.
up until something like, right up until I think the 60s, and then they sort of changed location through Carlton and stuff like that. But, it was
incredible.
Upstairs at the Princess Theatre all of that time, and the very first manager of 3XY was Harold Holt's father, the former Australian Prime Minister that went missing at sea.
Oh, yes, and the pool was named after him.
Yeah, I always fucking think of that.
Yes. I used to go to the Harold Holt pool in Malvern.
Did you go missing?
Need to throw a polywaffle in that pool. But, yeah.
Exactly.
It's great. So going down to 29, First Offence, Corey Hart, EMI Records. You would know off that album, Sunglasses at Night, Never Surrender. It kind of just had those two kind of classic hits, but Sunglasses at Night is still renowned for being a classic, brilliant keyboard synth and all over Stranger Things, you know?
Yep.
Which is awesome. 28 is Power Slave by Iron Maiden from EMI. Don't know much about Power Slave, but I can imagine Run to the Hills would be on it maybe.
Run to the Hills
70s?
Might have been a little bit earlier. Power Slave is the one with the Egyptian, and it's got sort of Eddie is like the head of a pharaoh kind of thing. It's like an Egyptian cover. I wasn't very familiar with that one as a kid. The singles were 2 Minutes to Midnight and Aces High.
Okay, great.
But yeah, I don't know too much about that album. I was into Michael Jackson 1984.
Yeah, they were sort of fading out a bit, you know. It was the real hardcore people with the jackets and the kick your head in dudes that would still be into that kind of stuff. But hey, 28, fantastic. I've got the next single off 27 that was charting Hot Albums, 3XY Hot Albums on the 2nd of November 1984. Number 27 is War by U2. Now, this is probably one of my favourite U2 songs, and it's very bass driven and it's brilliant. Here we go. Beat as One, U2 off their War album. Do you like it?
This is the third album and I absolutely love it. I agree. Yeah. I think a lot of bands sort of try to sort of copy the vibe of this album and the look of this album because it's very political and it's very earnest. There's something just like really honest and straight down the line with this album and a lot of people try to rip it off.
I love it. Very industrial sort of really, really good. And this is an interesting week because we've got a couple of bands coming up that have the same vibe and a second album that U2 is on this chart as well. Number 26, Breaking Heart, Elton John.
Oh, can I
John.
Just say singles from this album were New Year's Day, Two Hearts Beat as One, Sunday Bloody Sunday and 40. I'm not really into – I love this album because they still sound like an English – they still sound like a sort of an Irish UK band, you know what I mean? Whereas anything after Achtung Baby, I'm not a huge fan of, you know. It's – yeah, I remember them coming out with Vertigo and my mate like going, yeah, you two are back. And I was like, are they?
Sort of American Radiohead kind of.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, it
exactly.
Wasn't really, yeah. Fantastic. 26,
sorry.
Breaking Heart. No, that's right. 26, Breaking Heart, Elton John on Rocket Records.
Yep.
Didn't get that album, but I can imagine it was a brilliant album. 25, Breakout, The Pointer Sisters. That was a good album, RCA.
Ah,
was
fantastic.
Number 25. So you had Automatic, Nowhere to Control It. We all thought that was a man, but it wasn't. Automatic by The Pointer Sisters, which is actually a good song. I remember it being on one of the compilation albums. It might have been Hits Huge or something, and you just put it on and you went, oh, these girls are cool, but they're kind of mummy looking, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Which is good. I have the next one, number 24, which is the album is called Couldn't Stand the Weather, Stevie Ray Vaughan from Epic Records.
Stevie Ray.
Stevie
Brad,
Ray.
Brad loves Stevie Ray Vaughan, our guitarist Brad.
He does. Mm. This goes out to Cookie. Some Cookie love. Here we go. Thank you. Ray Vaughan couldn't stand the weather. Oh, you know, I used to be in a band like this at the Rainbow Hotel.
Oh, did you
Hotel.
Really?
Yeah.
I would ache to be in a band like this.
Oh, man, it was hardcore. You know who was in it with me? Mick Colopy, who we're doing the show with. Coronavirus the musical coming up. So he's in a, if you see Mick plays Hammond and sings exactly like this and has the phrasing and stuff.
Oh, wow.
But it was called Tiama and it was at the Rainbow Hotel every Sunday. And Chick used to own it before he died. The guy
I would have
went
loved to,
his to
have
funeral.
Seen that.
Yeah. And it was just a whole lot of Maori boys and myself and Mick and just did really good versions of Bette Davis tunes, and I used to love singing Bette Davis because I she was angry, you know. Oh, I just want to love you, like I just loved her, and a bit of Rufus and Chaka Khan and all that stuff. But yeah, now just so people are aware, Stevie Ray Vaughan was the lead guitar on Let's Dance.
Absolutely.
So I'm kind of thinking that this. The Let's Dance vibe would have actually helped him with his solo stuff in this year as well because
– Well, he was unknown. He was unknown when he sort of came onto Bowie, and not saying sort of Bowie discovered him, but this would have certainly boosted his career. So an amazing time for him. This album peaked at number 20, I think, in Australia and went to number 5 in New Zealand. So, really popular. Like, good on you, Bowie.
Yeah, and Stevie Ray Vaughan, an amazing guitarist, cool singer, just everything is cool about him. I remember seeing a video clip of his where he was playing his guitar in a hospital bed and I think there was a TV set blown up in the room and it was just so 80s, you know, him playing in his ambulance and the hospital bed. I can't remember the track. It may have even been this one. I'm not sure. Cookie would be able to tell me. But I remember being fixated as a kid watching Stevie Ray Vaughan in his hospital bed playing guitar because my biggest fear in dying is that you don't get to do this shit anymore. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's not really about dying.
That's right.
It's the fact that you can't play music anymore, you know, but who knows? So there you go, Stevie Ray Vaughan, number 24. Number 23, Diamond Life, Sade, epic.
Through Epic, this is the big one. Yeah, this is the big one with Smooth Operator. Smooth Operator not being released until August. The very first single was Love is King. Your Love is King
in
January.
Yeah.
Beautiful. We played that just the other week.
We did. Hang On to Your Love, great track. Frankie's First Affair, fantastic. Cherry Pie, beautiful. Why Can't We Live Together was also a fantastic track as well. So Sade starts kicking goals here and we're all starting to hear about her. Music had such versatility in these years as well. There were all different styles that you could get your teeth around and you go from Stevie Ray Vaughan to Sade.
Very huge range of genre in the charts and in the upper charts as well. Like you would have stuff like Stevie Ray Vaughan and Sade, which, you know, Sade is like lounge music, you know. It's a far cry
She's
from
like
sort
good,
of all the new wave.
Yeah, a good Adele, a brilliant Adele, you know.
Oh, you're not into Adele?
Not really. I like the one where she – the first track – But I think Sade as an artist is much more interesting, and I hate to say it.
Rolling in the Deep when she was fat.
Okay. No, Rolling in the Deep was okay.
Joan Rivers said she was so fat it should be called Rolling in the Deep Fried Chicken.
Oh, my God. Bless her heart. Yeah, well, that's right. She doesn't look like herself anymore, you know. But that's what happens when you get divorced, isn't it? You kind of lose the weight to get more cock. That's right. Everyone loses weight and looks better when they've been divorced. Just ask anyone.
That's right.
So there you go now. Number 22 was Stay Hungry, Twisted Sister, Atlantic Records. This would have been their first one as well, wasn't it?
I think so.
We're not
going to
take
it. I believe
so. Blah, 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 blah.
I think so, yeah.
But Twisted Sister lead singer is one intelligent dude. Intelligent. Went to court. Remember over the Hungry, what were the 12 or the famous 12 or
Yeah, the what was that? The famous 12.
It was about our second episode. Oh, it's a third
it
studio
was,
album.
It was.
Okay.
It was their first. Yeah, yeah.
Their third one.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe that. So we're not going to take it. I Want to Rock. But this is the only one I kind of remember. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But still, they were huge. And
Dee Snider, you're talking about.
Dee Snider, yeah, very intelligent. Took all those people to court when they put the explicit stuff on. And that's a great episode.
They were trying to censor music. They were trying to censor the content. And even like stuff, even stuff that we played, even last week when we played, I think we played Dress You Up by Madonna.
Yes.
That was put on the line, you know, as being like a sexually explicit song. And it's like, it's just not. Like the way that she delivered it, yes, might have been sort of very provocative, but it's just not an explicit song. Like it was just absolutely ridiculous. It was like a witch hunt. But we talk about it in our second episode. So go right back, guys. We're a lot better behaved back then.
Oh, I want to know. We talked a lot about vagina in the third episode about Duran Duran. I remember that one being out there.
We did
with
too.
With the hairdryer, remember, and Girls on Film. Now, about Madonna, have you seen the footage of Billy Idol driving to the supermarket with Madonna's first album on in his car? It's the cutest thing ever.
Oh, really?
He's going down to the shops. Singing, you must be my lucky star, Billy Idol, man.
Oh, wow. What is an old footage?
No, it's now. Now.
Oh, like now.
Today.
Yeah, wow.
So he's got some chick in the front with him and she's videoing him and he knows every lyric and it's just fantastic because I would be flattered as Madonna, you know. I would be like, oh, my God, Billy Idol. Amazing. Speaking
he would
of stuff,
pine for those days, you know, like it's very nostalgic music.
Yeah. You know what? I wonder if he liked it back in the day though. Because like
probably
me.
Probably did but didn't admit it.
Yeah, maybe. Like me, I'm starting to find different aspects in music like Skyhawks. Maddie and I are going a bit nuts for Skyhawks of late and I've had the records and my neighbours used to play the stuff but you just appreciate it when you get older because there's just lack of creativity and around. But things that should be cancelled, if this guy was out now, he would be cancelled. So this was number 21 and it was Rodney Rood Live, EMI. This little snippet I'm going to play is called Airport, Find Language,
Airport.
Drug Dog. Airport.
Yes.
It's
Airport,
really good.
Yes.
You know what I've been doing lately, trendsetters? I've been going out to the airport because my brother likes to go out there and find luggage. He finds all kinds of luggage out there and I thought I'd go out and find some with him. We went out and found a really good red port and a couple of things in that. And have you ever been out to the airport and seen those drug dogs sniffing around? Looking for drugs. They give them a lot of drugs, so they want more drugs. If they didn't give me any drugs, they wouldn't know what the fuck they were looking for. And the drug dogs, you can always pick the drug dogs. They're the ones with the little spoons hanging around their collars. And I was out there with my brother, and we found some really good luggage, and we put it in the van and that. And we come back, and we saw this drug dog sniffing around, and he sniffed around in this suitcase, and he licked up a couple of trips. And he went nuts. He thought he was a human. Thought he was a famous person. Thought he was Willie Nelson. Was wearing his collar around his head. He was singing, on the road again. Open the gate, now I'm on the road again. I can't wait to sniff some assholes with my friends. My dog's been laying around the house for weeks, no energy or anything. And I got the vet. The vet came over and said, well, he's been dead about a week.
Rodney Rood.
Absolutely genius. I'm sorry, but absolutely genius. And this kind of thing doesn't exist anymore.
No.
It's certainly not in the charts.
No.
But like
way.
this sort of comedian was very popular in the 80s. We talked about it in our comedy episode when we had Jerry Connolly on board. This was really popular to have the kind of like a kind of cabaret musician, a cabaret comedian, where they were delivering this sort of comedy routine, but it was all mixed up with music. So it would, you know, they would qualify for the music charts, and they were so popular. You had sort of I went to say Cole Joy, but you had like sort of Kevin Bloody Wilson. You had this guy. What was the other dude like really popular, sort of similar vein to this?
Ostentatious.
Ostentatious, exactly. But they were huge, like this kind of thing.
Well, because it was released on vinyl. It was released on vinyl.
Right.
So anything on vinyl. Someone came up with an idea to put comedy on vinyl and record the show, which meant you'd get a serial number to put on your vinyl and it would chart. Because in the old days, it wasn't like now where you put your stuff out without a barcode. They all had barcodes. Yeah. So the barcode went through the shop, they went bzzz, and there you go, and that's how they charted. There was an actual, I think it was a UFC number or something like that, where even when I did my first early CDs, you could get these barcodes separately so that you could chart, you know. No such thing anymore. Mm. But the comedy records on vinyl would actually chart. Rodney Rood, that was probably the safest one I could actually get off the record. So if you want to hear some Rodney Rood, have a listen. But I don't mind him. I think he was a legend.
The heckling was just incredible. He used to There was one that I just love, which was this bloke's got both hands in his pockets, must have two dicks. It's just a stupid joke.
Exactly.
It's just so stupid.
Yeah. But the thing is, Australians got their information from him, and then we're very cultured. Like we're very – here we are, we're the Bogan Rodney Rood. Rodney Rood, I'm sure, looked Greek or Italian, or he didn't look Aussie. You know when Aussies
he looks
look
like
European?
It's something, doesn't it? Yeah,
like
I always
Egyptian
thought he was British. Yeah, I always thought he was British, but he was born in Nowra in New South Wales. His name's Rodney Keft.
There you go. Yeah. Incredible. Mm-hmm. EMI were hot. EMI were a hot record company in this time.
Very much.
Yeah, but look, it's all on YouTube, guys, and we'll leave you the links on the show and all the links to the videos and what you can watch, and you'll love it. You know what I mean? Number 20. Yeah. Give my regards to Broad Street, Paul McCartney, EMI again. I knew that album was really big, was a bit too young for it. I was a bit too young.
Yeah,
you know.
100%. Absolutely.
But you know what?
I'm
My uncles loved it. All your uncles used to buy that shit, you know.
I bet. Yeah, yeah.
There wasn't too many Aussie barbecues where you didn't have Rodney Rood playing live, Paul McCartney playing live, Stevie Wonder playing live in my family's
Julio
house.
Julio Iglesias playing live.
Well, we're going to look at that because I still think that's piss funny for Australians to take him on board so big. Now, number 19, this is one of my favourite records of all time of the 80s. I brought this with my pocket money and I had the yellow vinyl of this.
Oh,
and,
serious?
Oh, yeah, I got the yellow vinyl. It came out and it's Parade by Spandau Ballet and by Chrysalis. And this is – the whole album was amazing. This is Round and Round, Spandau Ballet.
You're just my fantasy, and I will fantasize something more or less to make things started. We're the artisans, and we've been crafted. I wanna be a magical mystery. I wanna be a final history. This is the news. It goes round. Well, I was just beginning to grow.
Just the production on this album is just incredible.
Absolutely beautiful. I absolutely love it. I've become really obsessed with Spandau Ballet yes. ever since going to the Blitz Club.
Yeah.
Where they played their first gig.
Yes. And the BVs.
I remember this so well.
Yeah. Oh, look, I had the record and I remember feeling a little bit weird because it was so grown up in sound and I was only 14 and I'm like, oh, am I getting older? I'm listening to – because, you know, I love the whole record. This was my first concert I ever went to. I think it was Parade, absolutely, because I was 13.
Is that right?
So they had a big curtain and it fell down and then the band just came running out of this – off this curtain and it was just incredible. And they were all so ugly, like not. They were incredible looking. And you just, heart was like, oh, my God, they can play music and they look fantastic. Tony Hadley as a vocalist is still one of the most amazing vocalists in the world. And if I got a job with Tony Hadley doing BVs for him, I would be a happy girl, tell you what.
And you know what? I think he kind of – as a male vocalist, even though he's obviously influenced by Bowie, his own tone and his own idiosyncrasies really push him out as unique, you know? Like a lot of other vocalists around this time sound like a version of Bowie. This guy, it's like there are intonations, there are inflections. It's like that's him. That's Tony Hadley. That's no one else.
Yeah.
You know? It's so unique. I love it.
I love it too. Now, that was Parade, Spandau Ballet, number 19 on the 3XY Hot Album Charts, 2nd of November 1984. I don't think we've done albums before. I think we've just done singles with 3XY.
That's
so
it.
This is really interesting because
yeah,
you can
nice.
Sort of play a couple of tracks that you may not know or and stuff
pick
like
your
that.
Song.
And it brings,
we've never played Round and Round before.
No, we haven't. We haven't.
I love that
we've
song.
We've done I'll Fly For You, we've played. And my favourite episode we've ever done was when we discussed a Spandau Ballet track written about, oh, it was songs that, what the fuck do they mean? Was it Gold?
That's right. About kind of, wasn't it about like.
Great song, but what the fuck does it
like,
mean?
It's like a hidden message. It's like a hidden message to somebody, you know.
That's right.
Even though they're married or they're having an affair with somebody that is married. That's right. I remember we did it. Incredible. Yeah.
Number 18 is The Magazine by Ricky Lee Jones. I wanted to look at this song called Gravity. Ricky Lee Jones was incredible, and this is another influence that we had in the 80s that we – it was just another genre that was fantastic. Here we go. Ricky Lee Jones, Gravity.
Thou wounds that stir up the force.
Love her throwaway face. Throwaway voice.
You would
voice.
Never put the voice with the face, would you? Like
no.
at this time. Like you, yeah. She's sort of, she sounds very dangerous and I love that in a singer.
Yeah, yeah. I think Prince was a huge fan as well. And I can hear
Is that
Prince.
Right?
I can hear Prince in her. Like not the other way around.
Saying.
I can hear Prince's picking up on stuff that she does somehow. I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure he really liked Ricky Lee Jones. And if for all those, and I'm pretty sure she wrote The Horses, Darryl Braithwaite. She was the
she
one.
She did. Australians have so, unwittingly made her very rich. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
She wrote Horses and it came out in 89 and then Braithwaite covered it in 91.
Yeah. And I did it once with Rewind 80s and no one cared. I don't know why.
Is that right?
They asked for it for years with us. Oh, play the horses, fucking horses. And then we did it at the Hallam Hotel like 6 years ago and no one gave a shit. And I was like, get rid of it. Doesn't work. You have to be Darryl Braithwaite. That's it. Right?
Yeah,
and I know that, but you've got to throw shit to the wall sometimes and make it stick, you know? But it didn't stick. And we were so happy it didn't stick because we really don't want to do it. But Darryl's definitely made a fantastic career out of that. And not only that, Sherbet was incredible as well. That's a really fucked thing to say, Darryl. Sorry. Sherbet was – I think I'm a Sherbet fan more than anything. I'm getting very 70s in my old age. But
Sherbet more than Skyhawks?
Oh, fuck. Yeah, maybe. I love How's That? I caught you out, missed about, caught you out. Mm. You're an ass. I love it. I love it. I love secretive songs, you know. You go. So
Here you go. Ricky Lee Jones' voice sounds like a saxophone.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. Absolutely. Mm. The phrasing. And she was a fantastic musician.
She really was. She lived in Paris for 4 months when this was recorded. Can you imagine fucking going to Paris? Oh, you hate Paris,
everyone
don't you?
Everyone did, though. Everyone did. Every muso lived in Paris for 4 months while they did it.
Yeah.
It was really hip. Especially
Paris
with the
Paris or Berlin.
Mm. Yeah, that's right. Oh, look, I don't know. I don't hate Paris, but I don't love it. I loved parts of Paris where John, the Doors dude was buried. Doors dude.
Yeah.
Oh, that's not nice to say because Jim Morrison, Maddie will edit that out. There you go. So that was the magazine Ricky Lee Jones, Warner Brothers. Number 17 was The Swing, In Excess, WEA. What a fucking record. We've done a special on this, haven't we?
Absolutely. It's just like a perfect album. It's just fucking
incredible.
Awesome. Love
Nick
it so much. This is one of my first vinyls. This was one of my very first vinyls.
Yep.
Yeah. Might have been the first one. Can't
remember. Look, it was just incredible. The Swing In Excess. Now, we have done an episode to that album, I'm pretty sure.
Yep. Yeah, I'm pretty sure we have too.
I'm going to see if I can quickly Google it because we've done so many shows, guys. Okay. Episode 43. We were babies. The Swing In Excess.
Yeah, God, we were young. We were so
fucking
young.
We were young. We weren't even drinking. We weren't even off the tit. God.
So young.
It seems like it seems so close but yet so far away.
I wonder if we were
love it. Oh, we could have. I think we were. Because we were sneaking over. We were doing that shit. Sneaking over to each other's houses. Couldn't give a shit.
We loved
it. There were weeks in Melbourne or Victoria where we had 2 weeks on, 2 weeks off. It was like fucking working, wasn't it? You had to find out when you were allowed to go out and not, you know. There you go. Number 16, Purple Rain. Prince, Warner Brothers. Classic album.
Warner Brothers,
we've done Purple Rain as well, haven't we?
We did the album and the tour just not long ago.
I bet it was long ago.
Princey.
Let me just Google it. Princey.
Purple
Rain, the 80s montage. It was. Episode 220, Purple Rain. And that was a great episode as well. We love that. So get on to
episode
220.
This is just an ad for other episodes that
we've
done, really.
But you know what? People still go back and listen to all these little episodes because it could be an anniversary come up of the record or whatever. 15.
Now, can I plug another podcast?
Yes,
of course
you can.
I'm listening to a podcast called One Song and it's fucking incredible. It's played it's sort of hosted by these two dudes. One's a DJ, one's an actor. They're both kind of DJs pretty much, you know, producer DJs, fucking slashies, whatever. Big music buffs. And they basically sort of they unpack different artists and their sort of timelines by really zeroing in on one particular song. And they do Depeche Mode across two episodes. I listened to it just last week when we went down to Cape Shank to do the FinPro gig. And I listened to one half of it, like, you know, one special on the way down and the other half on the way back. The song that I listened to on the way down was People Are People. I was just fucking living People Are People in Depeche Mode the entire way down. And on the way back, the song was Enjoy the Silence, because they were the two songs that these DJs said were the most important songs for Depeche Mode at different turning points at their career. Get around it, guys. It's an amazing show. It's executive produced by Kevin Hart. And really quality show. These guys sort of, they're really good because they sort of release a lot of promotion on TikTok. And so people might have picked up, you know, their little grabs from TikTok as well. Fantastic, especially the Depeche Mode episode. So get around it. Love you guys. Thank you very much for, you know, your company on the way down to Cape Shank last week.
Amazing. So we actually are on TikTok as well with a lot of our little edits. But we need to start doing video, I think. I think that would be cool.
100%.
We'll do that definitely for Christmas or something.
100%.
While you're plugging something, I'm going to plug.
That's my hair.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's right. yeah, that's what the chick at Baba said. Let's fucking give a shout out to Gareth from the Queen Band. Forever Queen.
Oh, yes. What a great guy. We had a special guest on the weekend.
We did. Gareth from Forever Queen. What a legend. I loved it. And really good tribute guy. Some tribute people can get a little nuts. This guy is fucking normal and we love him.
He was
I had a
lovely.
Ball with him on Saturday
really
night.
Good friends of really good
Queen
friends
Forever,
of Kate Sobrano.
Sorry, guys. Yes, Queen Forever, guys. Check them out. They're fucking incredible. They've been around like for 18 years or something, and Gareth came in and did this function with us and we played four or five tracks behind him. Just such a pro. Love it. Now,
yeah,
while you're
– that's right. And he was really method with his Freddie Mercury because him and I shagged after the gig. No, that's not That's rubbish.
Oh, God. Could you imagine?
It's probably married.
Really, really great guy. Now, I also want to plug a podcast – Gadinski's podcast that his daughter has put out is absolutely incredible.
Kate Alexa.
Yeah, Kate Alexa has put out Gadinski. If you want to hear about leadership and you want to hear about strength and you want to hear about taking risks, get onto this because it's only a five-part episode, I think, five-part session, like, you know, it's got five episodes. And yeah. I loved it. It was really inspiring and she just reads about her dad and it's just lovely. And Gadinski really did break the rules for a lot of Aussie acts and Aussie gigs and just really, you know, made a change for the better.
Fantastic.
Anyway, I'm going to play a commercial now for our gig coming up in November the 23rd in Hawthorne. Here we go. Hello, Melbourne. We're coming to your area of planet Earth the 23rd of November for Christmas cheer. Governor's Hall, 27 Hall Street, Hawthorne East. We'll be playing all the greatest 80s hits and all our subscribers and people can come down and have a disco for Christmas. Saturday, 23rd of November, Governor's Hall, Hawthorne, nice and central. See you then.
When I'm with you, baby, I go out of my head.
Come down and have a disco.
Come down and have a crissy drink.
That's a bit camp, isn't it? Come down and have a disco.
Do you know what? I didn't write that commercial out. I just went with what happened. Can you tell? And I wasn't even drunk. Governor's Hall is in Hawthorne. They've just had In Excessive there a couple of weeks ago and we're going in 3 weeks and tickets are $20. You can get them on rewind80smixtape.com.au and they cheap, cheap. So there you go. Now we're up to, we've just talked about Purple Rain by Prince.
Number 15. We're halfway, but we're going to power through.
You can say this one, honey.
Number 15 is Body Swerve by Jimmy Barnes through Mushroom. We were just talking about Kaczynski. So there you go.
Amazing.
I don't know much about this album, do you? Oh, yeah.
I think it would be the first album, this is the first album before Working Class Man, isn't it?
Yeah, it's Too Much Ain't Enough Love. Album, yeah.
Yeah, Too Much Ain't Enough Love and Body Swerve by Barnsey. I probably got into Barnsey around Working Class Man, though. But
yeah, that's right. Yeah. This didn't sort of have a big explosive single. It was really banking off his popularity in Cold Chisel. It still did really well because he was extremely popular. But yeah, it didn't sort of like yield a big, big single. But yeah, he quickly got carried along into the next album, which is For the Working Class Man the following year.
Ain't No Second Prize was the single off this. Ain't No Second Prize. Where the horse and the train and all that stuff. That was a good single. I love that. Yeah, well, it says here, Ain't No Second Prize or No Second Prize.
I thought that was from the next one.
Have a look, babe, because I might be wrong, but that's the only song I really know off it. Promised Me You'd Call, Daylight Vision. Paradise, A Change Is Gonna Come, Thick Skinned, A Piece of My Heart, Fire, World's on Fire.
Thick Skinned.
And they said, Thick Skinned. That's what she said. Yeah, but anyway, look, it was a transition for Jimmy, and we're going to see that very soon in this chart, what actually happens here. But still, it would have been such a huge risk for Kaczynski to take Jimmy out of Cold Chisel, because Cold Chisel were like an epic fucking Australian band that were the fans going to like that? You know what I mean? It was a different thing to, say, Michael Hutchence, even in Excess or whatever. You kind of – they were such a more of a unit, like more of a fucking staple, you know, being
that's
Cold
right.
Chisel that I remember thinking as a kid, even with my little marketing pea brain at the time, gee, I hope they go for this Jimmy Barnes thing. You know, like are they going to go for it? Because Cold Chisel were just everywhere, you know, and we were playing in bands and everyone just wanted to hear Cold Chisel, you know.
Pass that
guy a packet of fucking cheesels, you know, like that guy yelled out at me. Really, really interesting time. I think it was Working Class Man where it really kicked in though. Number 14, She's So Unusual, Cindy Lauper, Portrait.
Yeah. Sorry, babe. Ain't No Second Prize was, in my head, it's No Second Prize is the title. I was like, what?
Yeah.
Yeah, but that was like the debut single and the big song off it, yeah.
And I love the video because he's riding the horse against the train. And I love that because I loved horses at that time, and he was racing the train and it was so tough. Like, fucking yeah, Jimmy. You know, that's what sold me. Because
that's
it was horse racing, No Second Prize, and it was quite symbolic, you know, with the horse
and that
the
was
train
originally a Chisel song. It was originally a Chisel song, but they never recorded it.
Amazing. I love it. I thought that was a great track.
Yeah.
Now, She's So Unusual, She Bop, Cyndi Lauper, Time After Time. Oh, my God. Fucking girls just want to have fun. Biggest album.
This one as well.
Yeah, this one. I was a Madonna fan though, and this is the thing.
Yeah.
I, again, like Cyndi Lauper a lot more musically than Madonna. When I was little, it was the other way around. You know, but I love singing Cyndi because it's quite tough and it's a bit of a challenge. It is a challenge and it teaches you how to sing, man. Like, she teaches you how to sing. If you're
Madonna
a little girl.
Madonna just had the marketing though.
That's what Madonna did, and even though her first album was quite high, Cyndi definitely had the higher voice. Mm. Mm-hmm. I just wasn't into women dancing around together. I didn't like women that much. And I still really don't.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like I didn't want to be with my girlfriends and talking about boys and shit. I never...
Having pillow fights and fingering each other.
Not even. Not even. I had one friend that I used to go...
You came into that much later in life, didn't you?
I don't even think I did. I don't even think I did. Like I loved one woman or a couple of women. Sammy, Ange, Dallas... I don't really like women that much. Hello. I love fucking hell. Who else? I've got a few women friends like Jules and stuff like that, but I never ever, I don't know, I never kind of invested that much in women. It wasn't until I was a little bit older. So seeing her dance around with all different cultures and fucking with the beads on and shit fucking bored me to tears. Where Madonna was rooting fucking guys.
You've got to be very selective of friends of the same sex.
You do. 100%.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
And you know what? And because I've run bands for 35 years, I know what women are like and I know what men are like. Mm. And I tell you who I trust more. You know, I hate to be an asshole, but that's how it works. Yeah. Okay, speaking of Madonna, number 13, Madonna, Sire Records.
Didn't play anything on.
Yeah, we love that. That album is just incredible. And so does Billy Idol. We'll put that link up with Billy singing Madonna in his car as well. Number 12, Heartbeat City by The Cars, Elektra. We love The Cars. Yep. That's another genre. I think that's fantastic. It's like synth rock, you know?
Yes. It certainly is.
Number 11, Can't Slow Down, Lionel Richie, Motown. One of my favourite albums, Can't Slow Down.
Still going strong with Motown, Lionel Richie and 1984.
Yeah. That's there's awesome. A couple of Motown records in this chart.
Gotcha.
Can't Slow Down, Running With The Night, Running With The Night. I keep saying running with the knife because that's what you say. Running With The Knife. Sometimes you have to be. Can't Slow Down, Lonnie Richie. Hello was on that where she went, "This is how I see you."
That's right. Yeah,
big head made of clay. But very good. Very good video. One of the best 80s videos, man. Scary, stalkerish, fucking what's going on? His life going to be okay when I get older? Is someone going to kill me and stalk me? That shit really
only
happened
in the 80s.
In Lionel Richie's. Number 10, now we're going on to Cold Chisel. 20th Century, Cold Chisel. This was going to be their last album they ever made. And I remember the time. I remember being sad about it. I'm pretty sure I'm right here, guys. Please write in if I'm wrong. 20th Century was it was a blue cover with all like, I think it was spaceships or something. It was
like
very
a cityscape
futuristic.
Sort of.
That's right.
Yeah.
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 I was saddened by this.
A note, we've got the kind of like final studio album by Culture and, you know, until they reform fucking
that's
whatever.
That's right. And they put out a new one, but the, like, God.
Yeah,
it was
in the 90s. But this is like the last proper Cold Chisel album. You're charting in the same year as, Jimmy. your first Jimmy.
And I really felt that separation. And I think that's what scared me the most because it was obviously going to work in a big way, but was it? You know, Australian Made, when they brought Jimmy out with In Excess and stuff like that, that's when it really kicked in, you know, like let's just put him out there with the best of the Australian. And the band was incredible. If you get a chance to look at Australian Made, it's sometimes on ABC TV every now and then. I'm Talking, The Saints, just incredible performances and one of my concerts where I first saw Chrissy Amphlett from the Divinyls and I just understood everything about music by looking up at her and shitting my pants. I went, that's how you do it, kids. 20th Century, let's have a listen to 20th Century and this is a ripper. Here we go, Cold Chisel.
Collapse and rearrange. I got to smile about it. I got 20th century. Yankees looking east and west before they cross the Ottawa. It's a Hollywood democracy, and really doesn't bother me. It's entertainment, baby, and explore. And then the KGB divides just what comes after self.
So I'm pretty sure that's live. Now, the one thing about Jimmy live, he was never fucking under the note. He was always on top of the music, sat in there like a fucking fat ass girl on the fucking music. Why can't a cold chisel fucking tribute band do that? I've never heard.
Probably pissed and high.
Exactly.
Pissed and high.
100%, yeah. Right? When you go and see, we've seen Cold Chisel cover bands because we've been on the same bill as them, been Rewind 80s. And Dallas put it beautifully in Tasmania. It sounds like he's got a chisel up his ass. And this isn't Jimmy. This is the cover bands that do the – I've never seen anyone sit on top of the music. They're all fucking under the note. It drives me nuts. Don't do it.
Yeah.
It'd be like –
unfortunately, don't do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
you know,
right.
You might absolutely love them, but you're not actually paying tribute if you – you know what
no.
I mean?
Like, a headband isn't else. All it is. Headband yeah. with a Japanese fucking
exactly.
word on it. I just thought about that today and I was kind of like, I've never heard a Jimmy Barnes cover band where they actually reach, they might do a certain amount and then they just get tired and die in the ass, you know. And this is the thing with Jimmy is that his voice just keeps going, you know. There you go, 20th Century. Now, number nine.
So, look, so much with this album.
Yeah.
Singles were Saturday Night and Flame Trees.
Saturday Night.
The band talks a lot about this album, obviously because it was their breakup album. They felt, Jimmy felt it was very rushed. It sounds rushed to him. And he said they would have worked another year on the album if not for the fact that they were breaking up. They just wanted to fucking finish it and get it out. Like, we've got to get Mark Opitz on the show, babe.
We need to have a
like
show towards him.
Yeah, that would be incredible. We've got to get Mark Opitz on the show, legendary producer, who was there with Cold Chisel from the beginning to the end, because it would be absolutely incredible. He didn't just produce Chisel, sort of legendary producer. But, yeah, there are a lot of tensions within the band. This is the – I believe the drummer, Steve Presswich, had been sacked and was replaced by Rayana on this album. But he did play on the farewell tour. Presswich did play on the farewell tour. There are a lot of tensions between Presswich, Ray Walker, not so much Jimmy as – Ian Moss, because they all wanted to sort of like push in different musical directions, and it was apparently getting to the stage they were barely speaking to each other. But oh, beautiful. Like Flame Trees just has a special part in my fucking heart, and I know it would, like so many Australian men, people, yes, men and women, non-binary.
Non-binary.
You know, but,
yeah. That's awesome.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But
Turtles,
but Australian
giraffes.
Men,
yep.
There's something about this song. It's one of the threads in your body. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah, totally.
Holding it all together. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. He was definitely resonating with the Aussie men and stubbies and board shorts and just stories, you know. And it's pretty incredible because Jimmy was in an interracial relationship. He wasn't even really Aussie, was he? You know what I mean?
No. Yeah,
but
yeah.
Aussies weren't ready for that, but they fucking didn't care, you know, and that's the reality of it. He really brought out that you can be who you want to be with, you know. All this work's been done for people and, you know.
Funny though, because he was sort of – quintessentially Aussie because he was somewhere else and he came here and he kind of was on the margins and had no fucking money and the father was finding it hard to get work because he was an immigrant and you know what I mean? Like that's that, yeah, exactly right. And that was all part of our family's history and stories and stuff
that's
like
right.
that. So, you know, I think it was all of that that kind of actually made Jimmy more Australian than somebody that was actually born here and having half of the experience, you know, anyway.
Yeah, that's right. Well, music gives you more experience and music is you just get to see a lot more and you get to especially psychology of people. Like you really get to understand the psychology of people and people will look at you like, how would you fucking know? You're just a singer. Mate, you deal with every single dickhead in a pub that's psychologically fucking knackered and you've got to speak to these pricks. It absolutely – you have to learn quick how to get the fuck away from them and then – yeah. realize that this is why they're so fucked up, you know. Music
somebody
was like that.
Somebody in my old band 10,000 said to me, you're incredibly good at having a quick conversation and moving on without the person feeling offended. And
yeah.
I said, yeah, because I've done fucking gigs, you know, like I've – like in venues, that is the art. Like coming up, having the quick connection and then getting the fuck out of there.
Yeah.
You know, without them draining your fucking battery.
Oh, it is because you just gotten off stage. You don't want to have a fucking conversation about your grandmother, you know. But it's true. It's true. And it's even harder when you – a woman in the band because you're kind of looking at all the men going, oh, God, there's that fucking cookie that's going to fucking come after my guitarist and I've got to keep him fucking out of the way. It's like babysitting, you know, in both areas.
Yeah.
Number nine, tonight, David Bowie, EMI. Excuse me, I got the burpees. Tonight, David Bowie. Never got this record, I must say.
This is the follow-up album to Let's Dance, yeah.
Yes, yeah. Blue Jean.
Same thing. I know nothing about this album.
Yeah.
I'll really have to sort of like get it in and around it.
It's funny.
This got Blue Jean on it, of course.
Yeah. I just asked, I said to Maddie, do you know this album? And he goes, not really. And I went, oh, my God. But he's Loving the Alien on it. Surely not, because I love Loving the Alien.
Yeah, this was, I guess, beginning of a period for Bowie that he wasn't really happy about because it just sort of critically and in terms of sort of numbers and everything, not in terms of numbers, obviously, because this is right up the charts, but critically, it was sort of panned a little bit. This album and the next album, Never Let Me Down, and yeah, it was like a period where Bowie just was a bit dissatisfied. So he had this like big explosion and a sort of renaissance with Let's Dance and then sort of during this period right up until sort of 87, a little bit beyond, a bit frustrating for him.
Brilliant. We must move on because we're running a little bit out of time. Now, Aussies loved this guy. This is number 8. I'm not going to tell you who it is because every Aussie barbecue, every grandmother loved this guy and I still don't fucking get why. But anyway, here we go.
Sound of rumors telling me to say, down here in the Caribbean, sunshine every day. All the pretty women dancing, dance the night away. The pretty bamboo coming in the way.
cuores abas abiertos. El visavio bordelo.
Oh, this record's cleaned a few houses, hasn't it? Oh,
absolutely. And you know what? I really think that in Australia, Julio Iglesias, although he was Spanish, he did a lot for Wogs.
Oh, gotcha.
I'm not talking about coming around and helping Dad build his barbecue.
Yeah.
I'm talking about like the acceptance.
Yeah, that's right.
Culture, because like I don't know if anyone knew he was Spanish. He was just sort of like he was European. He was Mediterranean. You know what I mean? And I think he did a lot for. I mean, Wogs absolutely loved him.
Yeah,
Italians and Greeks absolutely loved him as well.
Aussie grandmas like undie.
Oh my god,
undie droppers. You know. Like you'd go to your grandmother for a barbecue and she'd have this – there was always a room with an organ in it, right? And then there was a record player next
his
to the
penis.
Organ. And that's right.
Yeah.
No, you will not even his penis, but Jesus Christ, it may as well have been. And you had an organ and your grandpa knew one thing and he'd play, you know, and the organ and smile at you like he was fucking Liberace. Then on the other hand, you had – bloody a record player with Julio Iglesias and, you know, and then we'd go and play the Bee Gees in the fucking backyard. Like music was so fucking important in our childhood.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
This, to me as a kid, I couldn't put my head around it that we were listening to this shit. Like I didn't mind the English side of it, but I didn't like that either. I was an ABBA fan, which sort of was the same thing really, but they spoke in English, but there was still an
accent
there.
You know what? We weren't yet so tied to screens as we are now. We weren't the kind of visually obsessed beings that we are now. We were more oral, you know, we were more kind of audio in our kind of understanding of the world, you know, like music played a massive part in our lives in this time. And we were sort of much more experimental with music as well. So this kind of, a lot of this album is sung in another language. No, nobody even knew what they were talking about. Like, sorry, not just this album, his discography, his body of work. People just loved it. They loved his voice. They loved him.
Well, that's it. And 1100 Bel Air Place was Quincy Jones's joint. So I don't think anyone knew that when we had this record. Mm. But I just seen this European man on the record and they put
fucking what was his next number? Quincy Jones' phone number?
That was 1100. No, well,
did
I don't know.
Like
I think they used
Jones?
To. Yeah, I think they used to do records there. I think that's what it was. But
yeah, but pricks would have been turning up to his house.
Well, the production of this is fucking probably worth more than what Prince did. The brass and shit. Like you got to think the years, the money they would have spent putting this calypso sound behind him. You know, just in case you can't go to Fiji for Christmas. Get a Julio Iglesias album, you know. And then we're off to the Cuckoo restaurant where they sing fucking German in the clouds in bloody Ferntree Gully in Melbourne to listen to this fucking yodelay, yodelay, yodelay. I couldn't fucking believe the culture at my age, you know. It was just going nuts in my house. but yeah, there you go. Now, number enough about Julio, but look, what a genius record that was. Number 7, Woman in Red, the soundtrack. Now, this is the only soundtrack in this. Woman in Red, very funny movie. Do you know much about it, babe?
Woman in Red. What? Gene Wilder and Kelly LeBrock.
That's it. That's right. LeBrock.
Is it Gene Wilder?
Yeah.
It's Kelly LeBrock, definitely.
Yeah. So he wants to root her, basically, and he's married. She ends up in some lift or, you know, she's like a Marilyn Monroe and stuff.
It's the 80s.
It's the 80s and this is how men were, still are, but they were just a little bit funnier about it. Now, I've got The Woman in Red. Stevie Wonder was this. This was a huge album in my grandmother's house as well. Woman in Red, Stevie Wonder.
sitting at ringside, and I'm standing on the inside, and approaching is Miss Matador. I'm on the charge for the woman in red, the woman in red. Like fine wine, she's going straight to my head.
In Red, soundtrack by Motown Records. I'm going to go back and watch this movie because this is one that looks very clever and very funny.
Yeah, I mean, Gene Wilder is just a beautiful actor. Just like, actually, you know, I think everybody just thinks if you're a comedian, you're a fucking dickhead. But like, Gene Wilder is such a sensitive, beautiful soul, and actually an incredible actor, like really great actor.
Yeah.
This isn't massively. I mean, the movie itself isn't sort of intellectual or anything like that.
No.
There is a big nod. There's a big nod to sort of, I guess, Marilyn Monroe, because she walks. Yeah, she walks over the vent, pushes down the dress, and I always thought like this is a colored. You know, this is a modern coloured version of Marilyn Monroe, because when Marilyn sort of pushed down the dress over the air vent, that was all black and white, you know. And, you know, Kelly's got this like amazing red dress with the, you know, you cannot forget the body and the legs and the red panties because it's like a close-up. you would not have been able to get away with it in any other decade.
Nah, every dad loved it.
Yeah, and she's like a divine brunette as well, you know.
Yeah, yeah, and she's also in that fantastic movie in her undies again. She always got in her undies, Kelly LeBrock.
Weird science.
Like she's just absolutely divine.
And really lovely.
It was kind of hot around this time, you know, and funny absolutely to see an older guy go after a younger girl. Like that's the comedy in it as well, because there's so many old businessmen that think they can pull chicks like this and they really fucking can't. You know what I mean?
He forms a sort of fixation with her and then the end of the film realizes that he ultimately goes back to the wife without sort of really doing – he like gets right to the line and then realizes, you know. Yeah,
that's right.
Good bloke, yeah.
Number six, Under the Blood Red Sky, U2, Island Records. So that's the second album for U2, which is incredible.
More U2,
Yeah. Number five, Private Dancer, Tina Turner. And great album again, I'm Your Private Dancer, Dancer for Money. Awesome album. Number four, Eliminator by ZZ Top. You've got Legs. She's got legs on there. Great album. Really big for ZZ Top. Fantastic videos. Again, using the female as a sexy sort of chick in touch with her body and all that bizzo. But we loved it. We loved it. And just the synth running through that rock album we love as well, especially Legs. Number three, Born in the USA by Bruce Springsteen. Brilliant.
Yep.
Number two, The Unforgettable Fire. Fuck, I've just forgotten who that was from. Unforgettable Fire is – I've got a brain freeze.
Oh, not
– I keep going to say De Commissar. What a
fucking
idiot.
Guy's name? No, it's U2 once again.
Oh, my God, that's the third record. That's why I couldn't believe it was them, because I thought – what a big year for them, a big week.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, really huge.
I can't believe that. So if you're a U2 fan. That's a
really big breakthrough for them in 84.
Yeah. Number one is an Aussie band. Now, this is when Aussie bands used to chart. So we had an Aussie band opener.
This is massive.
This is massive.
This goes out to my brother Gray. I remember him having this, this vinyl sitting on the floor amongst the sort of milk crates, like right next to the record player when he first moved out of home. This was huge, amazingly Australian, but the message goes all around the world. It's Red Sails in the Sunset by Midnight Oil. This is the one with the incredible artwork, guys, of Sydney Harbour that's bone dry and it's been devastated by a nuclear strike. And it's just so powerful as a political message, you know, being Midnight Oil, who are quintessentially political. This is absolutely huge. Like, this was enormous at the time. And I always get this confused because I always think the title in my mind, the title of this album is 10987654321, which actually came out in 82. And it's because of the association with the countdown and nuclear strikes. And I'm sort of, I guess, mashing those two concepts together. This was produced by Nick Launay as well, who's another producer who we must get on the show. Very, very talented, and this is fantastic. So this is through CBS as well. So let's give it a go.
Here we go.
Not revealed to those assembled. They're taken for a ride, taken in his stride.
Where the generals talk, you better listen to him. Where the generals talk, you better do what he say. Where the generals talk, you better listen to him. Where the generals talk, you better do what he say.
There's a rumor in the ranking, someone talking insurrection. He wants to win elections with a certain satisfaction. The people are appeased. Long live the revolution.
The general's very pleased.
Rip a tune.
This is huge. And it's sort of, there's such... Once again, such a dangerous band. You don't know what's going to happen, you know, but you can't fault the production. You can't fault the musicianship or the vocal delivery. You don't sort of – it's hard to sort of pick what Midnight Oil's actually good at. You know, to say like they're amazing at this. But like you listen to the vocals and the gang vocals and the harmonies and stuff like that, so punchy and powerful. Really great in this track. Really cool.
Yeah, I love the drummer in this band. Love him. And
what's his name? Fucking
I can't remember, but I saw him at the St Kilda Fest, I think. And I was watching these guys perform and
Rob Hurst, of course.
Rob Hurst, yeah. And I just think he's amazing. He reminds me a bit of Blondie's drummer, Clem Burke. I don't know why.
Yep.
But
yep.
Anything that Nick Launay puts his signature on, I fucking love.
Yeah.
Fucking love. Yeah, like the absolutely. Yeah, yeah, yeahs, Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds, he's done Kate Bush, he's done In Excess, The Models, Midnight Oil, obviously, and Silverchair, you know, The Living End. And I mean, I'm not a fan of The Living End, but, you know, Talking Heads and shit, the guy's incredible. And I think when in the 80s Nick Launay really took a concept and just made it that 15% more interesting, you know?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
And I'm going to give him 15% because I don't want to take it away from the artist, but definitely lifted and escalated the sound of the product.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely right.
But there's our – you got any more to add to that?
There's our show.
And our show was this one.
Hot Hits.
Brought to you by the 80s Montage.
Beautiful, guys. Hope you enjoyed the show and the deep dive into 2nd of November 1984, the hot albums from 3XY. We love you. Now, please jump on board, get your friends on board, get them to like, share, rate and review. Give us 5 stars. Write a little comment in the comment section on whatever platform you listen to us on. But most of all, become a subscriber. Don't just listen to the one episode. Become a subscriber. Jump on board. It's easy. Just hit subscribe. Best thing that you can do is become a Patreon for as little as $2 a month. For $15 a month, you get the extra episodes, folks, where we get pissed and just talk shit. Come and see us live with Rewind 80s Band.
Yeah, Governor's Hall. Drop us a message if you want to come to Governor's Hall. We've got 10 free passes to give away. So Governor's Hall in Hawthorne, all you Melbourne people, you're going to love it. It's a really cute little pub. And we're going to have the full band there and we're going to have dancing, maybe a little bit of 80s montage as well. Come down and tell a few jokes and do some stuff for Chrissy, because you guys have been so amazing to us this year, coming to see the band and listening to this show. I get messages all the time. We've still got to read out about 25 messages. We will get there, guys. We're just a little bit – we've got sick families at the moment, so we're looking after them really, aren't we?
Yeah, praying for health for our families and for everybody out there, guys. Please have a great Halloween. Happy Halloween for the trick-or-treaters. And good luck on Tuesday at the Melbourne Cup, the race that stops a nation. Hope you're lucky and you win a little bit of money and you enjoy the day off and the Monday off as well, because let's face it, everybody's going to be sick on Monday. Just can't come to work. Enjoy your long weekend, especially if you're camping. The weather's beautiful. Take it easy on the roads, guys. Really be very careful this weekend, because it's it gets a little bit crazy as the weather gets nicer, everybody gets out there. So be very careful on the roads.
Very good. We love you guys.
And if it's music mateys
or cool shit from the 80s,
we're going to talk about it.
Unreal.